Welcome to Real Estate Radio Live, an informative and engaging podcast discussing everything you need to know about the world of real estate. Your host, Joe Cacera, provides you with insight and guidance on how to buy, sell, finance, and invest in real estate. He also offers real estate tax management strategies, new construction advice, home improvement tips, and much, much more. And now, to guide you around the world of real estate, here's your host and Real Estate Radio Live team leader, Joe Cacera.
Welcome in, Joe Cacera with Real Estate Radio Live. Thank you for those that are tuning in on the show, or we do social media. We typically do the shows Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, depending on schedules. It is a podcast. What we do now, instead of broadcast live on Facebook, just way too many technical problems, we do the show here in the studio and then launch the podcast, of course, and then put the video portion on Facebook for those that follow and see the show. For more information, you can always go to RERadioLive.com. For almost 9 years, the focus has been education and information. We have really evolved a little bit into a community show, I've been saying here for the last year or so. You know, Real Estate Community Live, what's that mean? There's a lot of stuff that goes on in the community. Certainly real estate's a big piece of what's happening, but in general, we live and work in a very, very unique kind of complex area of Silicon Valley here. And so Jack has come in, and we've done this show for, this is the second year. We started something new, right, starting something new last year. Kicked it off into growing your business, and now this is going to be, we had made a little mistake, I guess, a couple weeks ago. What was supposed to be part three should have been part three. We showed it as part four.
Yeah, it was mislabeled. This is actually going to be part four.
Kind of wrap up, right?
We're going to wrap up about these new laws, but I want to make a broader statement here, which is if you're running a business, you have to have in mind the view that the business is like a separate person, a separate entity. So even if it was you and your spouse or you and just one other partner, basically that creates a new entity. That creates effectively a new legal being. Now, people say, well, what if I haven't incorporated? The fact is, even if you have not incorporated, the partnership that exists gives rise to an entity known typically as not the best way to do business, but it's called a general partnership. Mm-hmm. Two people go into business, they shake hands. That's actually how Jobs and Wozniak started. Apple started as a general partnership with a third partner. Big mistake, particularly for a manufacturing company where, you know, things potentially could cause personal injuries. I mean, all sorts of issues come up. It's not the way to do business. There's like one law firm left in America. I want to say I won't even say who it is because they'll probably say, no, don't say that. But there's one law firm left in America that is a general partnership. Most law firms have become limited liability entities. The notion of a general partnership is if you're a partner, say, with Abe Lincoln, and Abe Lincoln had a partner, you're liable for the errors of your partner in the course of a business. So if Abe Lincoln's partner, riding his horse to court, mows down some pedestrian, Abe is responsible for those damages equally, and that's called joint and several liability. Now, most people don't do business this way, and even individuals that are running a solo practice will be advised to form a limited liability company, which is a single member such company, single member LLC, because in theory you can encapsulate the liability of that particular solo business into that entity. Okay. And you can do it relatively inexpensively, but the thing that you still have to be aware of is there's hygiene that has to be done for that entity. This basic hygiene, the most basic hygiene, particularly if you have shareholders, is you need to hold some type of annual shareholder meeting. Okay. Now, I know for a lot of people, and there's even some big firms out there, they're like, yeah, we're not even bothered with that. And I have to tell you, that can come back in a variety of ways to cause mischief later on. If the business does poorly and there's a creditor situation where the question is, did you respect the separateness of that business? So even if you do an annual meeting that's on the phone for 5 minutes and that gets recorded as all the shareholders were invited, the notice went out, it's a standard script that you run, you're better off having that meeting, even if it's on Skype or even if it's a conference line or even if it's a Zoom, is how people are starting to do it now, where you essentially say if there's a shareholder that has a beef, then maybe now's the time to raise what the beef is. And sometimes there is. You get some shareholders that say, why isn't the business doing better? Or why did you hire too many people? Or why didn't you hire enough? Or whatever. And you have to be willing to listen to that. Now, often thing you do when you're a corporation is you have a board meeting. And the board is an independent group, and it should meet at least once a year as well. In fact, I think the better boards meet once a quarter. I just came from San Francisco. Unfortunately, there's tremendous traffic getting down here from a board meeting. And it's a group that meets, and the company's actually doing quite well. I'll leave it nameless, but it's growing rapidly. It has offices in San Francisco and a number of other places throughout the United States and the world. And we started that business as just a couple of guys together. We had, like, no space, no furniture, no nothing. And, you know, it's probably on its way to becoming, you know, I'm going to say, becoming a unicorn. It's on its way to doing that. Now, that trajectory took quite a long period of time. And, yes, in the beginning, there was, like, maybe one shareholder meeting because we were meeting so often anyway, so it was relatively small. But we kept a minute book, and we have the whole history of how the company developed over time. That book becomes important in documenting things.
Yeah.
But the point I want to make about these new laws that becomes pretty important is we have not yet ingrained into the business world the way the annual tax return kind of ingrains it, that there really is a notion of an annual health report, or the way, say, you do it annual if you're smart and you go to your doctor at least once a year, to say, you know, what's going on with you? Because the last time I saw you, the doctor would be like, your chart says you weighed this, now you weigh that. Like, either better or worse. Like, what you haven't gotten any taller. You probably have gotten shorter.
Just wider.
And you've gotten wider. And, you know, you look at you, it's funny because you look at even some of these famous actors or actresses that have, like, gotten older over time. And, of course, they all seem to get chubbier over time as well. It's kind of
happens to the best of us.
It happens to all of us. And I think it's basically your metabolism slows down. But an entity, its metabolism never really slows down unless you close it down. The metabolism can live on essentially perpetually. Some people think Coca-Cola will live forever. It's a fairly old company. It's got a magic formula for delivering sugar that's called, you know, Coca-Cola and Diet Coke and so on. Now they've gotten into the water business, but the point is they have to have a regular hygiene check, which they do financially, and the market's expected. But I don't know if they do. They probably do because they're big enough. It's sort of an annual legal review. And some of the laws that are starting to take effect will pay attention to, are you looking carefully at whether you are complying with law? And so there are legal departments in corporations and in law firms that now label themselves compliance lawyers. This didn't exist years ago. Years ago, you were just basically a lawyer. You were meant
like
to know.
Like a business law attorney.
Yeah, you're a business
like,
attorney as opposed to personal injury.
Okay.
But now, within the field of being a business attorney, there will be lawyers who will be like labor compliance lawyers, health care rights compliance lawyers, privacy compliance
lawyers. That's a good point. You mentioned before, too, a good example is like ADA lawyers,
yes,
right?
Yes, ADA lawyers.
Yeah, so that brought on a whole new spectrum.
It's a whole new spectrum. Yeah. And indeed, now there's even a sub-branch to that. It used to be the ADA was, are your parking spots labeled?
Yeah, right.
Are your restrooms
access
labeled? Now it's gone virtual to the web. So the new area of class action case, is have you made your website ADA compliance? Now, you love this. It's like the website, a blind person wants to be able to see.
Boy, how do you do that?
Exactly. You have to have these add-ons that Microsoft and
or maybe the voice-activated
stuff. Exactly. These add-ons that are built into the browser. You have to turn this stuff on. Because Microsoft and Chrome, Google, and other folks provide some tools that allow for voice readout of the website. But, of course, you know, probably 99.99% of the public that's viewing a website is going to have a set of eyes or at least one eye that they can view the website from. But there is a certain minority that does get left behind who can then hire a lawyer, typically on a contingent fee. So we have seen more and more clients, and this is sort of an area of the law that is now developing behind all this ADA law dealing with the physical world, is the ADA law, the American, you know,
Disabilities Act.
Yeah, the American with Americans with Disabilities Act.
Yeah.
Essentially, Americans that have some type of disability, so maybe they're blind, maybe partially blind, they want to have the option to listen.
Mm-hmm.
They want to be able to, I mean, we'll get to a point, I guess, where the websites will even provide some form of tactile feedback. People are talking about that. It's mm-hmm. a whole area called haptics. But this idea that your audit has to include, are you complying with these nuanced areas where you can get sued?
Mm.
And typically, the lawsuit can be addressed by curing the problem,
mm-hmm.
but then you get tagged for legal fees.
Mm.
And the legal fees can add up to a fairly substantial amount of money. So we get these calls all the time that say, I just got this demand letter from someone who said, well, my website is not ADA compliant because it doesn't do this or it doesn't do that. And, of course, you know, there's always the same set of lawyers, more or less, because they're doing these mm-hmm. cases in volume, to try to collect essentially a statutory fee or some fee that's turned it into, hey, they're enforcing the law one mm-hmm. case at a time.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you do this annual audit, and a lot of businesses don't do it, I want to say that, as a business gets bigger, I'd say even as a business gets to above five or 10, certainly when you're above 30 employees,
mm-hmm.
there's all this sort of recognition that the business itself has more potential to generate a liability claim.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have to be more aware of what that potential is and then constantly be on the lookout. Now, businesses that get big enough, they hire in-house lawyers. But even in-house lawyers will say, I can only go so far. I can only see so much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's all sorts of laws that sort of would allow people, you know, sort of outside the U.S. to engage in what's sometimes called grease money or
mm-hmm.
bribery.
Mm-hmm.
That's considered a way to do business in certain countries.
Yeah.
It's completely illegal here. And it's illegal here to do it there. And you see sometimes these big companies that get tagged for this, you know, federal law that
mm-hmm.
says, hey, you cannot engage in any conduct that would constitute a bribe in the United States. You cannot do that even in a place where it's expected,
wow.
right? So you have to have your antennae out. And what lawyers do who do this work, and we sometimes do it, particularly if there's sort of a body of intellectual property, because there's even sub-branches dealing with, are you protecting your trademarks?
Mm-hmm.
Are you protecting your trade secrets? Are you protecting your copyrights? Are you protecting your patents?
Mm-hmm.
Are you making sure everything that's being invented is going inside the company? Are you sure that you're getting everything signed? Because you'd be amazed at how many times employees come in and leave and they never sign anything, but they get sort of an email version,
mm-hmm.
but there's no box that automatically clicks, which I'm kind of surprised
yeah,
the email systems
surprised.
Have not yet gotten to the point where you
mm-hmm.
can add a little tagline, press this box to
yeah.
confirm you agree with my email,
yeah.
and then create sort of an archive version. Microsoft and others that provide email services, they've not quite gotten to that point where
mm-hmm.
they add that functionality.
Yeah.
I suspect it will happen because
mm-hmm.
people want to know, hey, did you get the email? Have you read it?
Right.
And you see a lot of cases where someone will say, well, I sent an email. That doesn't necessarily count as an agreement. Someone could say, yeah, I got that. I kind of ignored it. That was crazy.
Yeah.
You know. And more people think, well, if there isn't a reply to an email, that means it's a deal.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say generally the law is sort of starting to lean in that direction,
mm-hmm.
but it's not completely moved 100% in that direction.
Okay.
Between merchants, there's all sorts of bodies of law that say, if someone sends you an order and you don't respond to it within 10 days, it's deemed accepted,
mm-hmm.
that sort of thing. You have to actually respond in some fashion. No, I don't accept these terms
right.
and conditions. So you have to be aware of like diverse bodies of law, all of which can play a role in litigation, all of which have to be understood and respected. And in many cases, it's just sort of like being aware, at least on a yearly basis, hey, this is something we should put some value into. So I was looking at this recently for this company because they part of the review that happened today was all their annual numbers. And I was like, the audit, just the financial audit cost last year, and I won't name
yeah.
any of the auditors, but it's a big firm, $360,000.
Oh, man.
And of
that's
course,
just an annual audit.
Yeah, annual audit. And of course, everyone around the table is like, man, that's a high rate. We're not a public company. We're, you know, I won't say what percentage of our revenue it was, but, you know, it was a healthy check.
Wow.
And you can think of it as like $30,000 a month.
Wow.
For a year.
Yeah.
Went to the auditors. And it's not like you'd say, well, you know, we had this issue, that issue, or another issue. And indeed, one of the board members said, yeah, we should have gotten that work done for like maybe $100,000 because he had experience with a similar sized company. And we were all looking around saying, wow. So think about that, which is a six-figure number to a financial auditor, which typically, by the way, of course, this company's got an automated accounting system. Mm-hmm. They have tax returns they could look at. So there's a lot of data, but they're not hand looking at anything. They may do some random sampling, but you wouldn't look at it. Now, from a legal point of view, it's actually a much larger body of information, but I was comparing and I said, well, how much do we spend with the lawyers? It's a big law firm that they use because they totally outgrew me, which was fine. I blessed the movement.
Yeah,
and when that happens, it's
a good thing in this case.
It's a good story, right? And it was like a fraction of what the auditors were. And I looked at it and I said, you know, because no litigation, it's a good year.
That's
when there's no litigation, no employment controversies, no arbitration, no real disputes. And I, you know, everyone was like, yeah, that was a good year legally. It was just a fraction. And I was trying to figure out, is there some common ratio? Because I don't think anyone has written, what is a ballpark percentage that a business will spend on legal versus accounting when it starts to grow and scale?
Mm-hmm.
You know, when it starts to get into big numbers.
Are most of the majority of the employees in California in this company?
Yeah, they've got employees worldwide. Most of them are in California. Most of the ones in California are in San Francisco.
That's pretty good because, let's face it, California is a
exactly.
pretty good
Yeah, you would say, although I have to say, you know, California may be viewed as sort of one of the most pro-employee places, but there are places like in France that are almost, once you hire someone, more or less you guarantee continued employment.
Wow.
So there are a lot of people that never open up branches in France. Wow. They do their business. And this is why this whole Brexit thing, talk about sort of a changing area of law, a lot of companies would form a branch in the UK where the employment law is far more fair or far more tilted towards the employer than France. And then they would do business typically from the London office with a representative, not an employee, but a true independent representative in France. And the view would be, if the French business is not there, we don't have to pay all these severance costs. Because you might have to pay. I mean, I had one story where a particular company made a mistake and hired someone in France, and like literally the guy was working for less than a month or so, and he got into a bicycle accident or a motorcycle accident, and the company had to keep paying him his wages because he was like recovering. So at some point he never came back to work. He was like, you have to continue to pay. So they stopped paying, and you know, he sued and he won. Their view was, you gave him a job, it's too bad for you. The risk was, and it wasn't like he was delivering a package for the company. He was like riding home or something on his bike, and
this
he got hit.
Sounds like the Bernie Sanders program.
Yeah, it's well,
I don't
it
want
does.
To get into that,
well,
but,
it does. Yeah. It does start in a way at the top, and a lot of people, a lot of people don't realize that there is a different notion of, you know, who's in control. And of course, you get to this political question of, is something that's more like democratic socialism or even what some people suggest is a form of communism a better approach? Of course, we rejected that idea many, many centuries ago. Mm-hmm. But there's definitely people that believe the other 99%, which is a large group of people, are not being served by the current economy.
Mm.
Of course, here in California, we're probably, most of the state is probably in the top 10%.
Right. Right.
Just considering how much wealth there is here.
Mm.
And, of course, you get to this question of how much law change can be sustained, because it seems to me pretty clear that California will take some steps to reduce the homeless, but at a higher and higher tax cost over time.
Right.
So then what does that do to the real estate business, to home ownership, to how much do you have to earn? what does it take in terms of employment and so on? And you do get companies that start to outsource. And by the way, I want to drop a footnote without naming the CPA firm, which is a big firm. And one of the things that they were saying about, well, yeah, we spent all this money last year on this big firm.
Yeah.
And they said, yeah, most of the personnel did the work from India.
Whoa.
Said, yeah, that price was
that
for
would
an
concern outsource. Me even more.
That price was for an outsource model.
Wow.
So I
someone
think,
looking into that. I hope.
Yeah. So they were like, yeah, this firm is really smart. Like they get 80-90% of the labor done. So they're making a lot of profit on this deal. And indeed, the way in which they uncovered it is they were trying to understand how did it cost so much. And they said, well, had we used all U.S. talent, it probably would have cost you twice as much.
Gee.
So it's a little bit like, you know, to some degree, we're seeing the effect of this outsourcing model where the internet is on everyone's desk, and of course the desk can be anywhere in the world, and wages are far lower in these countries, although India is probably catching up.
Mm-hmm.
And now I hear people are doing stuff from Bangladesh and other countries where you'd say the same thing is playing out.
Yeah, I would guess that, I can't even imagine. I used to, manage larger operations. I got away from that, thank goodness, although that came to play pretty soon again. But I can't imagine the laws and the changes of what it must take to do everything you have to do to not only interview people,
yes,
but who you turn down.
Yes.
I remember that was coming into play, Jack,
yes,
right when I quit managing,
yes,
years ago. You had to keep a log.
Yes.
What the interview, why you recommended, why,
yes,
you did not hire him.
Yes.
All this stuff had,
right,
to be done, even if you,
right,
didn't hire someone.
Right. When you get to be a certain size company, you actually have to do EEOC reports.
Yeah, right.
Those reports have to basically show that you're being fair. You're an equal opportunity,
right,
employer, which means they're going to look at the data, and you have to specify reasons. You know, it seems as though you turned down a lot of people of color. Well,
yeah, right,
they didn't really have the credentials.
Right.
We're sorry. We'd like to hire these people. It just wasn't possible.
Mm-hmm.
Or now in California in particular, which is a law I want to spend a few minutes on because I think it's one that it's either going to work or it's going to fail miserably, and the jury is out on which way it goes. California passed a law effective January 1, maybe January 2, because January 1 is a holiday, but the first of the year, first week of the year, that said if you're a public company and you have a board and the board is a public company board and its principal place of business is in California, so this includes Apple, Google, and others, you have to have, if you're a 7-person board, you have to have at least 3 women on the board. Now, most of these companies are all men. You could argue maybe it's mostly all white men. There's all sorts of debates on,
right,
is it discriminatory, you know, is it discriminatory in many other ways. But it clearly does not represent the female population in California. Mm-hmm. If you say females are probably outliving most males, so it's probably more than 50%. Certainly at least
50%. So this is for every publicly,
yes,
traded company?
Yes. Every company that's publicly traded, which means a certain size,
yeah,
they drew a line there. And some people think it's going to go further. It's going to go to private companies based on certain revenue,
okay,
as well. So they're inching their way towards forced equality. Now, what's the issue? Can you find females? I say to my wife, man, they're going to be all,
yeah,
over you. And these calls have started to happen to her.
Sharpen her resume.
Yeah, exactly. They're like, a PhD from Stanford, really smart, has done a lot of things, has seen every business from startup to public company. They're interested in getting talent on the boards because if they don't do that, they're at risk of a compliance checklist violation where, I don't know what the remedy will be. They'll say, we tried. Here's 500 resumes. We couldn't get these people, right?
Is it a fine? Is it a lawsuit?
Well, I'm thinking it becomes a fine. It's not clear what it becomes.
Yeah.
It's not clear. It's not clear if it's really, it's law, but some people think it's mostly aspirational.
Mm.
The truth is, if it works, we'll have more female input on businesses, which could be a good thing for a variety of reasons. But if it fails, that is, if somewhere in this company say, we can't find the talent, and we're just going to move to Nevada, we're going to move our principal.
Right.
I mean, imagine Apple said, we can't find females. We think California's law is screwy. Now, some case has been filed. I haven't been tracking it, dealing with whether it's constitutionally permitted to force that kind of required equality.
Right.
So we'll see what the courts do with that. But theoretically, if Apple were to say, or Google were to say, you know, we're going to have an operation here, but we're not going to have our principal offices here. Mm-hmm. We're going to move all of our principal offices to Reno. I mean, Tesla probably could do that. They've got this gigafactory there. We're going to do a bunch of stuff that basically says the executives are making decisions from another state. Now, maybe that'll be true. Maybe it'll be more virtual. Who knows? Mm-hmm. It would really send the shockwave through the real estate and the rest of business in California. And there's a few real estate people that think in the next 10 years that's going to happen. There's a few real estate people who have gone on record saying, the reason California may have hit the height of its valuation of real estate, and we've heard this for many decades over and over again, is that corporations are going to push back and say, you're imposing on our discretion, our business judgment, who we think would be the best board member, a forced quota that should not be imposed on private business. Maybe you can impose it on, you know, government, maybe you can impose it on nonprofits, maybe you can impose it on
others. So in other words, the it's hitting a point typically where some experts might say the price is too much to pay.
And you have
it
to
gets
wonder
to a certain point.
You have to wonder, like, if corporate taxes were to increase in California to a greater degree, if fines started to be introduced for you didn't have enough women on your board, you didn't have a good explanation for it. At some point, I would think a board and maybe the shareholders would say, yeah, the cost of doing business, or let's say all the females who could be on the board start saying it's going to cost you a big chunk of money to do there because, you know, demand exceeds supply.
Right.
At some level, you would think there would be a pushback and some company would set a precedent and say, you know, we're going to leave California. And if that happens, I don't know if they'll change the law. I don't know what they'll do. I think it's aspirational that we should definitely have a more equal society. I'm not sure you can force it. I don't sure you can legislate it. I'm not sure you can get it. I mean, and it may turn out to be one of those things that's sort of a passing fad. I don't know that you could turn everything into it's a perfectly equal world and try to legislate that into being. But I can tell you that there is a push underway in that direction, and depending on who you talk to, they'll say it's a good thing or it's a bad thing, and they'll not necessarily look at what the consequences would be.
Well, just a couple minutes left. What's the best way to wrap? Because this is the wrap-up of this.
We're in part four. We thought we'd covered. There's a lot more that could be covered about law because there are changes in lots of areas.
I think you're scaring a lot of people away.
I don't want to scare them, but I do want to make them aware. It's a little bit like some people start a business and they're like, yeah, you know, I'm just doing this on the side.
Yeah,
it's no big deal.
And
then they get sued and they're like, oh, really? I should have done this or I should have done that. And they often don't re-review their insurance because if you're really doing the full checklist, you start looking at what business insurance do I have, what business insurance do I not have. You start looking at what indemnities do I have and from who and what do I not have. And you get a checklist. And I think it's a good thing to kind of go down that checklist to try to understand, is there some area that can be improved over time? Because I'll tell you, and this is the punchline to this story, when a bigger company starts to come around saying, we're ready to buy you, as you know, most companies do not go public, even though that might be a big aspiration.
Yeah, most get bought or acquired. Or
IPO process is a very expensive process. A lot of IPOs do not succeed.
Right.
You know, some of the notable ones have succeeded really well, but there's been a lot of flops. Most companies, most of the time, get to a certain size, and they really can't sort of break through any further without a bigger partner, a bigger distribution system. You know, something like Coca-Cola's distribution, and if you get bought by Coca-Cola, as I think a number of companies have been.
Yeah, you got an automatic distribution channel.
It's huge. Right. The synergy is huge. Right. So if you're a water company and you get bought by Coca-Cola, you know what's going to happen. That's going to make its way into every shelf of every supermarket throughout the world, with a delivery system even in foreign countries that you would never even imagine to build. So that sort of becomes the goal. Having compliance hygiene improves the odds that you'll get bought for the best price. And this becomes something people only realize painfully late in the game, after they get to the point of, well, we have an offer and we're going through due diligence, but they're uncovering a lot of things we mm-hmm. didn't do.
Okay.
And it becomes like, yeah, that was something you should have considered doing yearly, if not more often, mm-hmm. and making sure that you covered it in some way, because those gaps end up costing you. So I've seen situations where businesses have just about gotten ready to be sold. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, it's like the last one that came up was sort of a sad story, which is the business was doing well. Everything was doing well. They didn't do what I would call the compliance checklist on how much open source software was being embedded into mm-hmm. their application. Because a lot of third parties will get apps done really right. quickly, often from India and overseas, by using open source, which yeah. is generally okay, except if you use the wrong open source and it has some restrictive license, mm-hmm. then that's going to get picked up in yeah. the audit, because okay. the audit company will come in with a tool that will search the open source. Now, there's no specific area of law to say, well, is there open source law? Yeah, it's basically what license mm-hmm. agreements you've effectively agreed to that you didn't even bother reading yeah. going into the deal. So there's these companies that will spend, you know, less dollars going in and think they have something really great, and then they'll find later on, well, the acquisition price is being cut because a lot of the software was not our original work,
okay.
and the open source license is going to restrict and require kind of a rewrite of that software. Yeah. So there's lots of little nuance like that that requires you to sort of have your eyes open mm-hmm. and be sort of asking,
right.
is there some liability in this that I have not anticipated that's going to come to roost down the right. road? And yeah. down the road can be often, you know, yeah. 10, 15 years for some businesses as they grow.
Well, for those that have continued to follow the show, thank you. But there's a lot of great information here, as you know, that to hopefully fill you with some education. But the key here, as we wrap things up, is all these things, you're listening to the messenger, the guy that knows yeah. it all here. So
I don't know it all, but I know enough to be dangerous.
About your business, starting a business, in the middle of business, hiring people, whether you should, you know, all stuff. And this is a reason why you want to contact Jack and his firm. So before we wrap up, make sure you give everybody a reminder where they can reach
you. Sure, so it's Jack Russo. I'm the managing partner at Computer Law Group. We're in Palo Alto in San Francisco. We still answer the phone, 650-327-9800. People still call. I think that's pretty important. In fact, we still meet people, and we can meet them in San Francisco or in Palo Alto. Of course, people want to know the email address, because that's how usually things get started. So it's jrusso, J-R-U-S-S-O, at computerlaw, that's computerlaw.com. And you can go to the website. You'll find a lot of things. I think I mentioned to you, I don't know if I mentioned it on air, we're one of the few sites, if you go to Google and type in computer law,
reviews.
We have lots of reviews. Yeah. They're all 5 stars. They're not rigged. They're really people that like us.
Those are legitimate 5-star reviews.
And people are like, yeah, why did you? I mean, I've started to ask people, what made you contact? Well, I searched you on Google. Okay. You're like the only firm in Northern California that has that many 5-star reviews, even as against big firms. And these are big firms, by the way, that have big inside digital marketing. We have no such being. I mean, we're not at that stage. But it turns out it is becoming more and more important to get feedback.
Yeah, it is.
And, you know, the feedback can be a good quote, and the good quote often will resonate for people.
No, it's great, especially the younger generation. They go right away to Yelp and reviews and Google, and they'll enter that information and find out for sure. All right, again, for more information, you know how to get a hold of Jack. As always, for me, Joe at RERadioLive.com or 408-838-9060. And
you answer the phone, too.
We do.
Often
do
on the first
the
ring. You're right there.
So we'll give him a surprise, but what are we going to – we'll get started on our next –
We're going to do another series that kind of deals with how people are really accelerating their growth.
Okay.
In the face of all of these laws and regulations, they're able to put the pedal down even more and more quickly. And I've got a few guest speakers we'll bring in to sort of ask them how they did it, how they're doing it, how they're keeping it alive. Because, you know, it's a competitive world, and as you start to do well, competitors take notice and things change.
So accelerating your business with limited risk.
That's actually the trick. You know, people, it's a little bit like investing. You know, you can invest with zero risk, but you get zero return, more or less. But you
take a little risk.
You know, there's this curve. It's called the efficient frontier. In business school, you study all the time. Well, how do you get the best bang for your buck with the least risk?
Right.
And, of course, everyone's searching for that. Some people think it's real estate. Some people think it's precious metals. Some people think it's a combination. There's some truth to that in terms of business, too, in terms of what you decide to focus your business on and how you decide to pursue it.
So we will continue that next week or the following week. Thanks again for tuning in. Again, for more information, go to reradiolive.com. Thank you.
You've been listening to Real Estate Radio Live. For more information on today's program, visit reradiolive.com. That's reradiolive.com. Subscribe to our podcast. Discover more at reradiolive.com.